morning to everyone. Yeah, yes, dear participants. It's my great pleasure to introduce to all of you our keynote speaker, Mr. Gerard Masayan. Gerard is the founder in 1992 and head of the Music Education Research Group at the EHRAM in Paris. He is also research director of the Science and Technology of Music and Sound at CNRS. His research domain is on music representation, which more specifically includes computer language paradigms, machine learning, constraints in visual programming, computational musicology, music modeling, and finally computer assisted composition. Gerard developed the first EHRAM environment for score-oriented computer-assisted composition. And in 1998, he created, with Carlos Agón, the well-known open music programming environment, which is currently used by numerous composers and musicologists around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please join the presentation of Gerard Masayan on creative symbolic interaction.
Thank you very much. I would first like to thank very warmly the organizers of SNC and the SNC 2014, and specifically Anastasia, who did a wonderful job in organizing this huge and beautiful event. Thank you for the invitation. So, I'm going to talk about symbolic interaction in the context of creating creative agents that are of enough machine musicianship to be able to play along with human and improvise with human. So, basically, what you need at the current time, an agent has to be able to evaluate the past, to analyze the present, the incoming events, and to have some anticipation strategies in order to build up the future. A few remarks. You are not necessarily linked to hard real time for this kind of intelligent behavior, because it takes time to come to a decision, even for human. It can take milliseconds, hundreds of milliseconds, and sometimes seconds, and sometimes minutes. It involves time and memory at different scales, just as in music composition. So the approach will be halfway between composition and improvisation. And a general remark is that it cannot be always fully apprehended by mainstream, traditional signal processing, even processing technology. You have to get into some different things in order to be able to emulate intelligent behaviors. It's not only a matter of processing streams. So you have to bring in synergy a combination of means which are, I will detail this during the talk, machine listening, machine learning, stylistic simulation, symbolic music representation and construction, and you have to make all these means work together to cooperate and sometimes to compete. So we're aiming at a multi-level machine relationship, smart musical memory, with some discovery and generative skills, contributing to the emergence of some creativity in the machine. So I will specifically describe an instance of such a system. I've been working with friends during many years, which is called OMAS, which had, during the past years, many siblings called SOMAX, Amprotec, MIMI, Native Alien, in many different centers, not only IRCAM. So it's an idea that kind of spread out. So we'll have some cooperation between real-time audio. I always say that music representation are formal knowledge, and we want to be able to learn and be on the fly during the concert time, to be able to just come up on stage, learn from musician, even if the memory is empty and naive at the beginning of the concert, and be able to hook up to what the musician are doing and and play some significant music, be pertinent. And this will be the last part of the work, very recent work. We want to be able to connect to instant contextual listening. we won't be able to connect instant contextual listening, that is, understanding what the musician is just doing at the present time, with vast musical memory, that is, corpus-based knowledge that you have learned offline. So, be able to connect very short-term memory with very long-term memory, including cultural memory. So, I call the term symbolic interaction, just as a way to say that interaction is not only a matter of signal processing, of reactive system, or event handling and event processing. It has to connect to some higher level representation that are usually used for composition rather than for interaction. So the idea is to bring together the advantages of different worlds. Interactive real-time computing on one side and intelligent content level analysis, semantic processing, formalization of music on the other side. So bring this together with the decision-making paradigm in order to be able to lead decisions step after step. Either by relating to long-term memory, that is, relate to an overall structure that you have and that define the musical context, or take instant decision and jump to an unexpected place and structure, which is really the improvised act that humans do so well and that is difficult to do in a autonomous way with a machine. Of course, you can do it at random, but it's a good purpose. We're aiming at liveliness in computer system, which is precisely this mixture of deterministic and unexpected or improvised behaviors, as you have in many of our methods. So just to quote what I said yesterday in Plato talk, the Platonic Rhizome, music is a synthesis of time from the dialectics, to put it in a kind of philosophical terms, from the dialectics of immanent forms and transcendent possibility. What is immanent form? When you are formalizing music, you have a bird's eye view over the whole structure, and it is kind of immanent. When you are into reactive system, interactive system, you are in causalities. Each new event conditions causally the next event, and is external to this. This is what philosophers talk about. Transcendent because it is external. Just a reference to this beautiful evening that yesterday. Academia. So, I will from now zoom in from a very brief description of what we are doing at IRCAM in the lab, SCMS. SCMS is for Science and Technology of Music and Sound. Then in my team, music representation, and then in my specific work with some recent and not so recent development of this work. So, most of you know IRCAP, so I won't detail this. It was founded by Kerboulez in the 70s, and it's a nice place where you have musicians and scientific and tech people working together. And the lab inside IRCAP is associated to the research and development department at IRCAP, and it gathers researchers, engineers, which are structures in teams. So, there's a structuration in teams, in themes. We have four main research axes, which are modelization, interaction, representation and languages, and foundation and theory, cognition and musicology. And the themes are distributed around this thematic division. So my team music representation, you see it here, and we have software for composition, for orchestration, for improvisation, performance, for following, and also a strong activity in mathematics and music that was developed in a workshop. So we have an analysis synthesis team which is working in sound analysis and synthesis with physical models, signal models, work on voice and in other topics. We have an interaction team which is concerned by gesture capture and modelization and mapping to sound and musical structure. We have acoustics team which deals with space, acoustical space, acoustical instruments and acoustical minds, which is that is perception and cognition of sound in space. And a musicological team which deals with chorus and music analysis and musicology of contemporary music. If I put a lot of software, so I have circled here software that are related to music representation, and I was I will specifically talk a little bit about open music and much more about OMAX and research, of course, that's behind it. So this is the research team, the research themes in the music representation team. So we have problem paradigms, computational ecology, symbolic interaction, which I'm going to talk about today, and symbol-to-signal articulation. And these are the PhDs that are that have been conducted in the team. So since the birth of music representation, that which is the 92, we had around 30-35. PhD works hosted by the team. So we're going from the past to the present, and I have put little stars to the PhD work that have contributed to this symbolic interaction thing I'm going to talk about today. Also a lot of publishing activity, books collection, and creation, co-creation with colleagues from all the world of the Mathematics and Music Journal that is probably heard about. So this is open music, as described in books that we edited a few years ago, with works from composers that joined the high diversity of this software. So open music is really our music composition, computer-assisted composition environment, and it's purely graphical, just as the Max software, except it's more designed for offline works, offline design. Works of designing musical structures and scores. So here are a few example screenshots of open music. And the interesting thing, the concepts in open music that I designed with Carlos Tagu years ago, the idea is writing form in time. Remember, music is a synthesis of time in a pseudo-Deleuze quote. It's the idea to have a series of couple of opposition. So it's a reflexive visual programming environment, multi-paradigm, that is, you can do functional programming, imperative programming, logical programming, and many other things. And you have to have a series of duality. You have the duality between structure, that is form, that is this immanent thing, and process, that is computing in time and causality. So it's easy to mix them together in open music. There's this duality between deep level and surface level, deep level of computational description of things, and surface level of editing surface musical objects like scores or signals. And it's easy again to go from one representation to another, which are summed up in the duality between signal level representation and symbolic level representation. Okay, it's just a short animation of using open music. You have patches like in Max, you have a visual program which represents the computational structure, and then you can you have maquettes which are computational structure in time, so you have a time axis, so you can take a patch and drag it into a maquette and it becomes a musical object that deploys in time. And then you can look at this this object with a computational view, that is the structure, the formal structure out of time, or the surface structure, that is the musical object here, it's a signal, the score. And then you can take this maquette, which is which becomes a single object, and drag it into another maquette, building up hierarchical structures of musical form. And then these very complex structures can become again a single point in the computation. So you drag it again into a patch, and it becomes a single source of computation. So the loop is closed, and you can go from computation structures to time structures to surface representation and back to and it's very practical, and it's in the position like this, and use it a lot. So now zooming in to the OMAX and symbolic interaction project, a tribute to many people, many wonderful people who contributed to this idea and this environment, and you can actually use it in musical setups. So what is all about? The initial idea was to virtualize musicians, so be able to listen to musicians, model it, so to speak, clone it, so to speak, and play with this clone in order to be able to interact with the musician. And then the idea would be to go beyond the idea of clone and to create this invention possibility for this agent. complex is a live music performance. The data are audio streams that arrive in real time. The model is a fine model that captures the musical logics underlying the famous musical streams. And it outputs musical sequences, hopefully with the same logics and with the same sound, if this is what you want, with different sound if you want to synthesize your sounds. But the idea is to mimic the behavior. So the resulting situation is human musician playing freely along with the virtual one and creating the title. That was the initial setup that was very inspiring for us and helped us to design the first prototypes. So I tried to capture this idea in a kind of epistemological setup in order to understand what we are doing. So it's pseudo-cognitive because I'm not a person from cognitive science or perceptual studies, but it's cognitively inspired. This is what I imagine that's actually happening in the world and that we are trying to simulate. So suppose you have a musician who is improvising with along with fellow musician. He has a memory, he has learned things in his life, and these things are evoked. Information doesn't come from nothing. So it's often reacting of things that you have in your brain, maybe combined in a different way. This is the evocation relation. And the musician is listening. There's a listening relation. He or she is listening to other musicians and listening to him or herself, right? Because an improviser. Has to have this kind of loop, listening to what he or she is producing in order to correct incremental. Okay, so we have this first loop. And then, all these images, that is the current context of the musical setup, musical improvisation, the music that is produced by the musician, reverse in time, and in memory, because all this is memorized. And creates memory images of all this information. So this is the memorizing or modeling relationship, because when you are memorizing, you are also compressing information. You are also modeling this anyway. And so you have this double loop of self-listening and listening from what's coming from this virtual past. So the idea is that Thomas ratifies using here a term of jargon, understand jargon, verifies, which means makes, materialize this abstract thing and try to emulate it as an inspiration to the musician. So you see there are plenty of levels here because there is a natural phenomenon of double loop in the musical situation, and then you have a software which is kind of verifying this very situation, and you have to interact with it, so you come in you're kind of in a very recursive situation. But it is, I think, what music and specifically improvisation is about. So we began the research, this idea on compression, and it was pretty much inspired by the Schumann of a fellow researcher, this is San Diego University. It was shown that finding the optimal behavior of rational agents is equivalent to compressing its observations. The proof applies to involve seeking agent in any unknown environment which can be simulated by a computer. Another way to put it, there is a close connection between machine learning and compression. A system that predicts the posterior probabilities of a sequence, given its entire history, can be used for optimal data compression. While an optimal compressor can be used for universal prediction, so the relations can be reversed. If you can do universal prediction, then you can generate. So compressing is a way of modeling that helps you to generate things. So the very first prototype was based on the very well-known compressor called the L-set, the L-set compressor. That takes a sequence and builds up a kind of dictionary of segments into this sequence. I won't detail, but you can represent this as a tree. And in this tree, some parts will act as a context. For instance, here you have the context AB that appears in the sequence,
Another part will act as a prediction, which is if you have the context A, B, then you could predict that it's going to be followed by A or C. Very close to the Markov chains, but you can go beyond the Markov models with this kind of things. So this is optimal coding and universal prediction. I won't detail this, but it has the good properties. It means that when you have such devices, it's equivalent to having not a single Markov machine, but an infinite number, a virtually infinite number of Markov machines that adaptively converge to model per second. So you are not linked to a certain Markov order, but you have just as many order as the seconds needs, and in an optimal fashion, in order to the model, in order for the system to generate movement. So basically, it means that if you have this sequence and you notice that you have a pattern repetition, you can use this information to build a new form by predicting from the end of the pattern to the end of another similar pattern. And then you have a form that emerges that was not in the initial sequence, but that's interesting because it has a statistical properties. Okay. This is kind of well known. So here are a few very early results. Years ago, so we were just modeling MIDI files and trying to generate pseudo music. So, for instance, a generation in the style of Bach, the Jaka. In the style of Charlie Parker with an ugly mix. To leading musician and working along with Bernard Bach, a famous French jazz player. He's an expert of the real one playing a concert in Bach style and then the model playing the construction.
We've got to stay at the single level that we have to explore high level really
label them as parts of NASA.
And this will be cognition, ideally cognition aware. So
you have to discover an alphabet structure at the point of the screen. You have to learn this into statistically into some form of structure. And then you want to do a strategy for generating and rendering new sequences. So you do this in real time, interacting with musicians. So the three processes have to happen in a
concurrent way and cooperate and compete.
So as for listening, for simple monolithic signal, we use a pitch coloring software like gene frequency following and quality function from which you can extract clean non-node insets and lab insets. And if we are dealing with an arbitrary complex signal, then we have to go to a step and be able to extract units that are meaningful spectrally and timbrally. So we do this in MFCCs, med frequency gastrum applications, that give you some vectors, multi-scale vectors that represent the spectral shape, and we do some adaptive quantization of these vectors with some local group averaging from some geometry, some Euclidean geometry, and the precursor then can extract all these and call them signals. So every time you have such clean information, you have a musical frequency that is cut for a segmented frequency signal and labeled, and will be able to recognize if it happens to be off or something very similar. So for pitch, it's quite easy, and for timbre, depend a lot on the cut for the signal. When it's purely MIDI, then it's, there's a slicing mechanism where you slice vertically polyphonic slices every time you have the burst of that an event. And you keep all this information, for instance, you keep the information that an event has been sliced but continues in the next slice. So when you will be generating new sequences, you'll be able to regenerate the polyphonic structure. Okay, the formal learning structure. Is a structure that we found in the literature, the formal language literature, and also the bioinformatics literature. It's a structure called a factor oracle, which is a kind of graph, which is this way, incrementally by the unit sequence from symbols from left to right. And we're not detailed, so we just give the interesting properties that we find in this structure. So this is a factor oracle. Representing a sequence of symbol A to B from left to right. So you have two sets of arrows, forward arrows and backward arrows, and forward arrows model a factor automaton, which means that this is an automaton that recognizes factors of a word, the subwords of a word. And the backward arrows have a very interesting structure. They work in using the original algorithm as construction names, but actually they are the ones that we're interested in because they give this structure, which is a roadmap into the pattern organization of the sequence. So every backward or suffix link connects two patterns, two similar patterns, exactly, so two exactly linked patterns in the formal alphabet case, but two similar patterns if you have functions that can detect similarities. So you see that you have this connection from a pattern with its first occurrence starting at the beginning. And this arrow structure actually can be deployed into a tree structure. If you take one of these arrows and put it up, you get a tree, you get a forest of different trees. Every tree completely explains the genealogy of the pattern. See? So this pattern is connected with this one, but then also with this one, and then you have a different pattern on the left of this one, but then the longer pattern, which is dark red and gray, itself is repeated in another part of the sequence. And here you have the same information with a linear sequence here, and you see that the numbers are the lengths of the pattern, and you see that the trees are ordered in lengths from root to node and from left to right, if you want to have this dimension, which helps you to achieve a lot of optimization when parsing the tree You know, the, for instance, you are generating this thing, and you, you would like to, you know, instantly all the other parts in the musical sequence is a similar pattern, and we would find them very easily because of optimizations due to the finite result loads. So this is the whole structure. Here, an example by Archapint. Archapint in his thesis and several papers also used this factor oracle similarity structure, but with different geometries. So it's not the Euclidean geometry anymore. It's an information geometry. I will not detail this. But apart from the geometry, you have here sound signal, which is in this case the seventh piano sonata, played by Buddha. It's an ancient recording, so it's very noisy. And here is the factor oracle that recognizes the different states pertinent to this sequence. And it's interesting to see that it's not so difficult to reconstruct the formal structure of the sequence. So we see you have here layers corresponding to segments, which explain the schematic structure of the sequence. So it's a good model. It's a model that is powerful and that is very friendly and comprehensive. So you can use it in construction set. Another way to look at this model is that it's a correlation matrix, which is sparse, and which is given to you instantly as a sparse structure, instead of constructing a correlation matrix, and then locating existing substructures in the matrix. When building incrementally the factor oracle, you build directly the sparse structure, so the correlation matrix, so it gives you the roadmap into the things. Okay, this is just another representation, these arches. This is a representation that you had in the summer of the organizer, connect different parts of the sequence, with different colors and different thickness of the arches, which represent time. So, for instance, if the similarity criteria is pitch, then the patterns can be equivalent in pitch, but with different time durations. So, the thickness of the arches tells you music is accelerating or slowing down, etc. This is an improvisation by Stacy Tam, where we see that this kind of representation can also be music and musicological analysis and signature of improvisation or of any musical sequence. So we give a few indications on how to listen and how to learn from the model that we have to generate. So this is the general navigation heuristics on top of this model. So this is the factor oracle. And suppose that you have generated so far this sequence by just reading and so replicating the music that you have done. So we have not invented anything. Then you would like to jump to another place and you would like to find a similar context in order to jump to the same context. So the idea is to look a little bit in the future of the sequence and to evaluate for each point all the possible jump candidates which are represented under the form of a tree. Remember these are the tree. They are organized into the tree. So you do this for a certain window in the future. And suppose that you find here a tree that's interesting with a part of this tree that connects to this state. It means that you have a very good complex here, which is replicated here, and then you have it legitimates the idea of jumping from here to here. So first you move to this part by continuing to replicate, and from here to jump. So you have a free switch way of recombining in real time the sequence that you are learning. Maybe, this is the overall architecture, but I won't detail. And now I will show a video recording of what's happening in the software in real time. So we have, as input, saxophone improvisation. You will see the factor of the building of real time.
Similarity structure in this part of the music, but nothing in between. It doesn't mean that you don't have patterns.
outcomes related to this premium pattern that is very strongly represented here and very strongly represented here.
You see that this is very interesting in digital analysis. You have a first thematic sequence, which is very similar, then different material, and then you are re-evoking, recapitulating, or re-evoking something that happened at the beginning. This is real, real-time music analysis. So it's easy from this to do higher level segmentation by just gathering and clustering all this pattern information. So you will see higher level segments appearing. So here we have a segment. Here we have another segment, it's different, so it's a different color. Because not many relation, not many pattern relation between the segment and the segment. And if you go further, you see that you have a relation between this green bar and this green bar. So you are able to segment the segments into higher level units and then relate them in one point another. So this is also online musical analysis, but at a higher segment level. Then, once you have remembered that all these processes occur simultaneously, so as soon as you have begun to model something from the musician, you are able to play. So how does it play? It just navigates, as I said, with the study I showed, on this representation. So you can see a sort of computer improvisation on the same sequence, and you will see this red cursor moving around the factorial, and then jumping when it finds an interesting way to jump. And before it jumps, you will see a phantom cursor telling you the place where it's going to jump.
Played with it and it puts
interesting material. Bernard is playing the piano, and Omar is so in all this situation, the memory is empty at the beginning of the concert, and it's on us to play only by learning on the fly. You're not obliged to do that. You could learn offline, maybe musical information, and use it for the concert. But here, the challenge is to see what you're able to do by just learning on the fly. So, explain the idea. Suppose that here you have the MIDI representation of a musical sequence where you have a chorus line, a solo, and an accompaniment chorus behind the solo. So, and the solo is visible here in red, right? Can you see this? Anyway. So, you can analyze the solo exactly the same way we showed, but you have still this background information, this sound rate information, that you can use in order to annotate, to scan all of your musical units with annotation, with labels, that gives you some additional information on what was happening at the time the chorus was played, what was happening in the background. In that case, the harmonic background, but it could be any kind of background, like a rhythmic background, or even external things, such as this visual context, whatever. You can scan a context in visual information. Here, for harmony, we do it using chromograms. So this works on the MIDI and the signal and the audio signal, so there's no difference. So we're using chromograms with an echoic memory inspired by Toyen and Krumman's model. We say that every time a note appears, its importance grows using this curve here. And when it stops, it doesn't disappear instantly in the memory. So there is a persistence in the memory of a trace of this information. So it decreases using this exponential. And then the chromogram is built up upon this idea. So now here we have your memory model, just as I explained, with units separated and arrows linking units and giving patterns into patterns. And you have a live input. This is what the musician is doing. So if the musician is currently playing this ground unit here, then you are located somewhere in the memory. And you are wondering, what next? And in that case, as a difference with the traditional Omax, you want to decide what next depending on what the musician is playing. Okay, so you want to favor paths in the memory model that will bring you in a play that is similar to what the musician is just instantly playing. And by so doing, we are going to extend the accompaniment paradigm, but to something more general, something that works even in the case of pure improvisation. So you can decide to jump in a play that is significant with regard to what the musician is actually doing, or to a place which is significant with regard to the label, the context annotation that they extracted from the musician, as can be mapped to the label, the context annotation, as it is associated to the states in the model. So in that case, what you are doing is that you are generating an event which might not be similar to what the musician is doing, but which could be linked to a certain context which is similar to the context of the musician. So, just to give a very short example here, we have analyzed the famous Keith Jarrett concert. I'm sure all of you know this concert. It's pure improvisation. So, we have analyzed the left, the right hand, in the context of the left hand. So right hand is the main information, but the left hand is the harmony, with this chromogram and echoic memory system, is the harmonic labeling of the left hand as it is. Then we have an agent who knows this purpose and can improvise, so to speak, the Keith Jarrett's right hand. Then we have another agent which plays anything, and from this anything we extract the same harmonic information, the same harmonic level. And we drive the improvisation of agent in order to be able to replicate the style of Keith Jarrett's right hand, but always staying in the harmonic context that is extracted from the inputs, right? And this is done for the harmonic annotation, and this is done also for the tempo and pulse annotation, so the the right-hand improvisation will also keep in time with it.
So here we input, it's called Autolinker because we input a jazz standard called Autolin Paris. It's again usually modified because we could not exactly the same with the audio, files. And Laurent didn't do it with the audio files for stupid rights and problems. So we input Autolin Paris and our model of his right hand improvises in the harmonically coherent and the tempo coherent way on top of Autolin Paris.
Way and the way it happens in real life because we're not looking for exact replication, but for similarity. So this is a very powerful model, and it helps in obtaining very much better musical results, especially considering, and this will be my last theoretical statement, and then I will just give you an example, considering that you can listen to many different things in the input environment. For each audio input, you can listen to many different musical parameters, that is, you know, label annotations, and you can sum up into a global activation function. But the interesting thing is that you can listen to it yourself. So while the system is playing, it can listen to itself and create the activation pattern in its own memory of what it is playing and combine it by linear combination with the activation pattern of what's coming from the environment. And you can weight all this information. And this is very good because you can decide that the system is more oriented towards itself, that it's just generating what it learned, or directed towards the environment, just reacting instantly to what's happening in the environment, or any point in. And I will, so this is a major improvement. I will just tell you, just to finish, a video of a concert that we recorded in June at Irkan during the Open Doors. And it's here, I guess. So I have three videos that I will be very short, except. First video. You will see saxophones playing, and Omar is improvising freely from memory learned of jazz voicings in the style of Bill Evans. But it's free improvisation, purely free. Nothing is designed in advance between the musician and the computer. So it's.
Sequence.
flexible and organic, and the mission has a feeling that it is in control, because depending on what he plays, and you see that sometimes he launches this kind of call and the same reacts, because it depends, it's a very strong thing in the memories of the Twitchers tend, which is not always the case, but tend to go to this location. So the mission feels that he can, to a certain extent, control what the agents are doing. And just the last example, where you have an external corpus, so we learned the cabbage trick by Schoenberg, and the mission improvises on top of the Schoenberg cabbage trick, but the agent plays the Schoenberg cabbage trick, not literally, it improvises it, re-improvises the Schoenberg cabbage trick. The musician improvises on top of this, the system listens to the musician, creates a new clone of the musician, and then the three together, listening and again, everyone listening to the others, try to co-improvise. And at the end, the percussionist enters into the dance, but he's not modal, it's just a play. It happens. It's
this is it. Thank you for your attention.
I would like to thank you very much, sir. Oh, you're very, this is very, very interesting presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.